okay, that will be solved easily by doing this. So your idea is now validating even more.
It's becoming a better idea. Until and unless there's such a problem that cannot be solved, okay, until that, your idea is still valid. Like for example, someone shared something on Republic in some of the groups today, I don't know what it is, that you cannot invest from India through RBI. So your idea is gone there. If you had an idea of say Republic, you cannot invest from India, so it's gone. But if you have another idea which can be bypassed, can be solved, that's a good idea. And everyone's vibing with the same idea, that is something that you should go ahead. And then you have to see who's doing it already. If someone, that most of them are already there, right? Or if it's not there, then either you're too ahead of your time again, right? Or there's something weird. Because you should also think that if I have such a great idea, baki log bhi kyun nahi dena? Right? So you have to think from that much. Or you take an existing problem. This is the best part. Like you take an existing problem and try to solve it. That is the best thing that you can do. Better than anyone else and in a different way than everyone else. When you get a new different business model, that's when you kill everyone. Like, there's a lot of example. Jio. Before Jio, all your Vodafone and Airtel bills were 1,200 bucks easily or 800 bucks easily, right? Still, some of the plans are there. Because that time, we didn't know what the actual price of calling was. But then Jio came and said, was sub-free. That's a marketing gimmick. They got everyone to their platform. But after that, they still charge only 300 bucks, 349 rupees or whatever they asked. Now they're lower, 149 rupees or something. Then we realized, oh shit, we were paying so much to Vodafone and Airtel, right? But they disrupted the model in such a way that the big companies are already established with that kind of revenue, and when they have to cut down, most of them collapse. They can't cut down so much. If you're telling Airtel or say Vodafone, that's what the problem happened with Vodafone. So they have hired so many people because they were getting X amount of revenue. Now if you suddenly say someone has come in and cut their legs off and your revenue has to drop down by 50%, either they lay off so many people, but if they lay off, how many can you lay off? Your operations get affected. If your operation gets affected, where will the people leave you and go back to the Jio or Airtel, right? That's, it's like a massive down break. Airtel survived. They survived, right? So this is a very difficult aspect. For example, I don't know how many of you have heard Zerodha. The reason why I like them is, obviously they copied Dropbox. I mean, it was very similar to Dropbox. I don't know who copied who, but it was very similar logic. So it's great. But at that point, when all the financial services firms were broken, HDFC, ICICI, every firm, all of them charged very similar brokerage, 0.05%. Okay? And then they built it up to such a big thing, and they've hired so many people in the securities department, they became a shortlisted company, became all these things. Now suddenly someone came and said 20 rupees flat fee or 30 rupees flat fee. So if HDFC tomorrow wants to do 20 rupees flat fee, you know how many people they have to fire? Yeah. And if, you know, if they fire so many people, you know what the stock price is tanked down to? So they can't. So this guy will always be the 20 rupees guy. Now someone will copy this 20 rupees guy, like Upstart scam. They'll still come up. Right? So Zero became number one, right? Yeah. But the big guys can now have to be happy with number two, number three. Or invest in this. Something like that. So when someone comes and disrupts the entire industry like that, solving the same problem at a better value, you still have to.
But what if a company comes in just to disrupt the market? It doesn't. It is not profitable yet, but it is providing services at cheap just to disrupt the market.
And
all the other companies are broke, and they raise their price again, hike their price again.
Most of the companies do that. Most of the companies do that. See, as long as you're giving value, people are coming to you.
Yes.
For you to slash your pricing and give it discounted rates or giving it at loss, you have to have some kind of value that people are coming to you, no? For example, if Flipkart came out and gave all discounts, right? But if the delivery was bad or if the feedback was bad, even if they gave discount, you still wouldn't buy from them.
Yes.
Like today, when you want to buy, most of you will go to Amazon.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Most of you, even though you know Flipkart is, say, cheaper, the same product is cheaper, you still somehow feel that Amazon's better because refund to
hai,
delivery to aata hai, everything's fine. So you are okay to pay 100 bucks more for that brand premium that you have, or the customer service.
Yeah.
So that is it. I mean, Amazon was not profitable for so many years, but they kept giving value, built their name, value, got funding again. Then they grew into such a place. Now they have the bargaining power to reverse that and start charging more. So then you become profitable. But it's a very risky game. Better, the safer side is to actually give value from day one, keep your profit margin from day one and grow. Simple.
Sir, if like somebody like for 3-4 of us are like starting up, okay, and we are like giving, for example, services and everything, and we have to like, we are on a tight budget, like really tight budget, and we are providing to the clients and then getting the money, but the margin is low. Then again, we have to like pay the our colleagues and everything. So not employees, but the core team, the 4-5 people, okay. And then like how the co-founder, so in the main question, how should the co-founders take money in the start or they should charge later?
First of all, if you are getting such low margins, you should not even do that.
Okay.
Why are you struggling so much in life to get low margins where you're barely able to pay other people and not yourself? Hmm. Okay. There are 100 businesses where you can try to get higher margins. Hmm. So why are you in that business?
Okay.
Or if you're in that business, do something different where you can charge higher margins.
Okay.
That solves all your problems that you mentioned.
Okay.
Don't go into a business where you are doing the same thing what other people are doing, charging the same market rate, and you're going to be uneconomical at the same time. Doesn't make sense, no? Matlab, you're working like a donkey and still getting nothing, barely anything. So you don't want to sustain, you want to make money, not sustain your money, right? So that's it. Think of a game which has better margins.
Rudan, is this applicable for digital marketing too? Because I guess you once said that that market is saturated, that there's no need for you to enter there.
Market is saturated because there are thousands of digital marketing agencies in India. Thousands, actually more than thousands. There's a lot of digital marketing agencies in India. Most of them doing the same generic thing. If you look at any digital marketing agency, they'll be like, they have big fancy words, but it's the same thing. First, they'll be like SEO. Okay. UI, UX design, website design, is okay? Or the flow of the website and all that. Then they say performance marketing, which is basically marketing. On Facebook, Google and stuff like that, they do marketing. But they say performance marketing plus analytics. Analytics is what Google gives you, called Google Analytics. Same thing, they will show you in a better dashboard or whatever. So the structure is the same. You're still marketing on Facebook, Google and whatever. Then they do copywriting, creatives. That's where your difference is. Your idea, marketing is only about ideas, right? What type of idea should hit with what type of people? Right? Your copy should be different, your creative should be different, your ad should be different, and all these different kind of firms do different kind of innovations in there. But it's saturated to a point, but if you come out with something maybe new, something maybe very different, then you can charge more than other people. Like, I will do this and I will teach you another style, or I can do it in this place where no one else is doing.
Okay, like digital marketing but for creatives, just like that?
No. But digital marketing has all the creatives, right? Digital means you have to make something to show people.
Okay.
But maybe some extra that no one has done that you're also doing. I don't know. Figure it out.
So you're saying like basically targeting a particular niche or something kind of
stuff.
Digital marketing.
Ultra niche is better because now your margins increase. Instead of being a generic player. Now imagine you're a digital marketing agency who specializes in FMCG products.
Okay.
Of say only skincare.
Okay.
You're the best person there. And everyone knows in the industry that you're the best skincare marketing agency. Obviously you can charge more now. You can tell them. At that point you can actually tell them. You want to go to that other person, you can. But I'm doing L'Oreal, I'm doing all these other skincare brands. I'm damn good at what I do. So you can, my charges are this. You want to come, you come. You don't want to come, don't come. Now, a lot of things, this happens to us also a lot, right? Because we also charge a lot. We don't believe in that sustaining model. So we said, look, we have a lot of companies. We're good at what we do. That is why we charge a premium. So they said, no, it's too expensive for us. We say, okay, no problem. You have that other agency, you can go to them. We say, cool. 6 months later, I get an email again. Can we have another meeting? Right? Because sometimes they go, they burn their hands and come back. Happens. Sometimes if they do well, great for them. I have no problem. But most of the times what happens when the generic thing happens, they go, burn their hands and they come back. That also happens.
So Shashank, like let's say we are picking up a certain ultra niche or niche, just that's it. And should we be like, it might be a stupid question, like should we be like first developing it ourselves, like let's say I'm into diet or something, or like nutrition or something, should we be like developing a certain some business for ourselves first, so
marketing,
that we can,
or you're talking about making something,
like let's say building a company itself, and like I have built this company now, like Gary V had Wine Library, right? It was his own business kind of thing, and he did it, and then on that basis he's now taking a lot of businesses, covering a lot of businesses, people are giving him a lot of business. So like, should it be like, should we start out like, if I want to start tomorrow, let's say, should we be starting out with our business first, or should it be like just sales call people and like in this very specific niche?
See, first of all, you should, if you're planning to start something, you should start something that you like. or you're already an expert in, or you're passionate about. And you all should know what you're passionate about, right? Now you might find an idea that is damn good. Okay, so for example, say I think I will cut this coconut tree and make something out of it. Okay, but three of you all might not be passionate about it.
Yeah.
It's a good business idea.
Yeah.
But if you're not passionate, you will always lose to the next guy who's passionate about it. So rather, say for example, if you're passionate about something, right? Say making tires or whatever. You will make, because you're passionate, you will make innovative tires. You will always keep thinking. It won't let you sleep. You keep thinking, I think I should do that. Whereas the other guy who is just doing it for business sake and is not passionate will have a peaceful sleep.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the other guy who is passionate will always keep thinking, I think we should change that. He'll always move. So for example, Elon Musk. Right? He's very passionate about electronic vehicles. That is why he keeps innovating. It's always new technology that's coming out. Whereas the other guys are either just copying him or coming out with something similar. But he's living, sleeping, thinking only about Tesla. Right? So if you're starting, first start with something that you know. Or if you don't know, become an expert if you feel that's your passion, and start with that. If you think you need to do some FMCG brand and you like it, you're passionate, but you have no idea what to do. And a lot of people ask in the group also that, sir, I want to start business, I don't know where to start. Obviously, no. If everyone knew, then everyone would start a business. Right? So if first find something that you like, okay, that you can only do it while you're reading something.
Reading?
You have to get exposed to something to know that you like something.
Mm-hmm.
Like you might like something called iron ore. You never know until you're not exposed to that.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's like tasting ice creams. If I had given you like 10 ice creams and I had not told you what is what, until you try, you don't know what you like. Like you have mango, you'll be like, oh, I like mango. And chocolate's also good, but I like mango more.
Mm-hmm.
So then you eat this more. So until you don't know what's there outside, you don't know. You have to read a lot of things. So best thing is to take one industry report. There's a lot of industry reports for free outside. Just put, so for example, education sector industry report on Google. You will get EY's report, you'll get PwC report, free to download. Sit and start reading. There are a lot of traction reports that come out for free. Any other industry that you might think that you like, read up on. Something will hit you there and you'll be like, wow, this is damn interesting, I want to know more. That's what you start.
Any plausible website that has these reports for free, because usually
Google best.
There are
still reports.
So I'll tell you what, just Google anything, put PDF in the end. You'll get a lot of reports. If there are not a lot of reports, there are a lot of articles around it. There's 100% information outside where you can read and understand.
So you don't have to like pay in business.
No. No. Like you just Google right now education, you know, education sector report PDF, you will get 5-6 PDFs right there. And they're extensive PDFs, 60 pages PDF by EY. You can actually go to EY, PwC and Deloitte. Okay, they have something called Research Wing. You can go to the Research Wing. They have a lot of reports on each industry. So real estate market, they have a big thing. But these guys have an overview report, that entire education industry or entire real estate industry. You want to go more focused into it, you have to dig deeper, kind of thing. But you'll get a sense of what's there in the market. So that's how it is.
That
again depends on whether you like it or not. No, if you like something, you'll go full deep into it. Think about it. But if you like something and if it doesn't let you sleep at night and you're always thinking about it, you will go buy books, you will read more, you will find ways to go deeper. And if you can't find knowledge online, then you will find industry experts and go sit with them and talk.
Mm-hmm.
Through your networks.
What's the best industry to enter into right now?
Every industry is good. There's no industry that's bad apart from plastic, but there's no industry that's bad. I mean, every industry can be disrupted, right? You should not see that, okay, this industry is trending, so I should go there, or that industry is trending, I should go there. It's trending because there are 10 passionate people sitting there and making it trending, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you're passionate about, say, some small thing like automobile screws, but if you're so passionate about it and you make some innovative thing, you will make that industry trend. Right, I said something on the group today, like Elon Musk made electric vehicles trending. Wasn't trending.
Mm-hmm.
We had Reva in India also, long back.
Yeah.
Nothing happened, right? He made it cool. He made it trending.
Mm-hmm.
Steve Jobs made iPhone and Apple. But phones were there at that time. It's not like it wasn't there. But he made it cool and trending. So it's not like this industry is good or that industry is bad. Every industry is there. There's a lot of scope for anyone to enter and disrupt with technology. It just depends on who will do it when. If you don't do it, someone else will do it for sure. Eventually, in given time, someone will come and disrupt something or the other.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the world works.
If I want to know about GST, but I'm not financially, so I can't read that code in the statement.
Of course you can. I can read it, but
I won't be able to understand.
You'll understand also. So, when GST came, even I didn't know what GST was. Right? No one actually knew what GST was when it came. You Google what is GST.
Okay, there's clear text which tells you everything. Now there's financial terms inside that you're talking about.
Yes,
that is very confusing. Google the financial terms. If you really want to know what GST is, first there are a lot of videos. First, the initial GST that I rolled out, the first one, was so complicated that even I couldn't understand. Because the vendor from here takes it, someone credits it here. It was like on web. Yeah, it was too difficult to understand. So you read more articles on it. Okay, then I didn't understand one weird term that was there. I googled that term and read that. So there are some people who don't know what inflation is, which is fine. Google what inflation is. There are videos about inflation. Right, so learn more, become an expert in that. So when me and Varun were becoming experts in blockchain, completely new industry, no one knows what blockchain was at that time. We were only confused what blockchain was and what crypto was. Like, we didn't even know for a long time that two things were different. Then I have read at least 15 to 20 different reports and I've read a lot about it. Kept reading. Achha, aisa bhi hota, aisa bhi hota. This works this way. What is private blockchain, public, all the different types. It took me at least a month to know what it is, not become an expert, to know what it is. But it takes time. It's not like I sat 24/7 and did that. But keep reading, keep subscribing to stuff. You see something like it, keep it in the side. Get up in the morning when you're traveling in train or bus or auto or whatever, you read something. Best is when you travel, if you get travel by taxi, and if you stay, if you have walk in lower period, you have anyway 30-40 minutes of commute.
Yeah.
I know what a lot of people do, put earphones on, close their eyes, peacefully listen to music, sleep, get up, are yaar, calm aa gaya. This is what people do. I've also done. This is what people do mostly. But that same 30-40 minutes, keep your music on. Not saying don't keep your music on. Little lower the volume, keep your music on. Open Economic Times, open Mint, and open Bloomberg. Bloomberg will give you world data, world news. India, Economic Times, and Mint. You don't have to read Times of India and stuff like that because Uda Sip, stupid garbage is there. Economic Times will give you exactly what Yes Bank is doing here, how much people are raising what, why. It's a short read, bro. It's like 300-400 words. Then you go and you just get that knowledge. And tomorrow when someone asks you something, you have that much knowledge to be like, because they did that, no? Very similar. That's it. And you're listening to music also. Instead of closing your eyes, you're opening your eyes. That's it. As simple as that.
And in UI and UX industry, what is the best? Webflow will the best or the coding will the best? Because actually the new
Webflow is disrupting coding.
Yes, because new sites which are coming, which are very creative, is made on Webflow.
Correct.
And the big guys, big blogs are there, which are having their website is made totally on code.
Correct.
So what should we learn?
So this is an interesting fact. Did you ever think in the past when you were learning CS or whatever,
yes,
that there'll be a software where you don't know HTML, CSS, but you're building websites? Who would have ever thought of that? Some passionate man sat in his garage and said, I will automate this process of building websites where even a non-tech guy can build it. So I actually know how to do websites on Webflow. But if I open that inspect element, I don't understand anything. What div block and all,
yes,
no
yes,
chance.
Yes.
But I started reading now.
Okay.
But now I know little bit. But I'm not an expert on it. I don't know how to change it. But I know boss, ye idhar jata, ye idhar jata, ye idhar jata. He made it very easy for me to understand.
Okay.
So who would know? But yeah, but if something new is coming out like that, adopt it. Learn it faster.
With
and
this.
If you already have a background, it's easy for you to make websites. So if I give you a website project, I give him a website project. He knows Webflow. He'll give it to me in 3 hours. He'll give it to me in 3 days. Who wins? He only.
Yeah.
Same quality. Chalo. Yehi jeete. So why you're limiting yourself? All the new technologies come, learn it, adopt it, get your hands dirty in Webflow, make one or two projects and learn it.
Actually, I was going to learn Webflow, but I'm thinking of learning code. So I'm thinking not to learn code, just learn the Webflow.
Learn both.
My advice would be go about doing fundamentals first. And it would be just 4 months. I am into CSS SaaS now. It's around about 4 months now. And after that, any which ways, market will be asking you to doing it in WordPress or Webflow only.
And the thing is, you still require a little bit code for Webflow too. You want some special effects.
Embed and stuff like that.
Do both. Not CSS specifically, JavaScript. Because it will be Webflow won't be able to do certain things.
You want
things.
Animations or stuff like that.
Yeah, so do both. So you become an expert. I just explained this for so long. You have the video of that or no?
Which one?
The bottle theory.
Mm-hmm.
Prototype sample. Mm-hmm. Very simple. Prototype and sample it first before you actually build anything. Research you've done, you figure out that this bottle is good to build. Make one. go sell it, make 5, go sell it, make 500, go sell it, start.
What if the product in itself is something which is very expensive or it is for a different class of
people? Like what? If you're building a huge machine, like
premium
thing, or one machine is so expensive, then you have to do a lot of research on whether it's good or bad.
And
even if you do that, even if you get an order, right, if you build one prototype, you should have money to build, or else don't build it.
Okay.
So have money, if it's a 5 lakh, if you're building an ATM machine, for example, you should have that much money to build it first, or else don't get into that game, right, get into something better. But if you build an ATM machine, and tomorrow that you have to, like, sell it, right, now someone gives you an order of 100, and you don't have, obviously, money to pay, right, but the bank gives you this loan. If you have, it's called letter of intent, the order, if you have that, you go give it to the bank saying that, look, someone's given me an order of this much. Mereko thoda working capital de do iske liye. And jab paisa aega, main aapko wapas de dunga. He will charge some interest, give it off.
But then it will be becoming very much risky for you because if you have an idea of Hyperloop, then you cannot dive into Hyperloop. You have to create PayPal first.
So the reason why people are diving into Hyperloop is because they have so many billions of dollars that they can afford to do some small projects. For them, it's a small project.
Right.
Right. So start with something small which is easy and controllable and for you to access. Then jump into the bigger things. Once you have money, jump into bigger things. Right? No one goes and builds a school if they don't have money. They do classes.
Classes.
Then they go into school. That's how it is. So yeah.
Okay, how do I start? So basically I have a own goal of mine that is all coming from Pajama Prophet. I want to be a freelance app developer. Within the next 6 months, let's say 6 months, I want to at least learn enough to start and at least take one project of my own. Within the next 6 months,
that's
I don't know how big of a goal. So let's take, for example, within the next 6 months, I have learned enough, I have taken few of my projects, and within the next 1 year, I am kind of a good, okay freelancer who is able to take some projects. And is doing work and is okay, he's earning something. But how do I make it bigger than that? I mean, like,
because
if I
you
want
just
to
said that
business.
You
want to
become an okay freelancer. If you have that attitude,
like,
it's going to be very difficult for you to reach that level that you see. You should say, I want to become the best. Now, if you're striving to become the best, okay, of an app developer, first you learn. Yes, 6 months, 7 months, you screw up big time. Be very happy when you screw up. If you fail, you should be extremely proud of yourself. Because you're now growing because you fail. If you were successful all the time, it would be very boring in life, trust me. So fail, burn your fingers, burn your hands. Then you reach a point that, okay, I can build some apps very easy. Easy ho gaya abhi meko, UI, UX, I know how to build an app, I know these programming languages, very easy. Start stepping up. Okay, now what is the new trend in the market? Now there's complicated apps as well. Now, not everything is that simple, right? If you have to build a Swiggy tomorrow, it's highly complicated. So you start becoming the best in that. Once you start becoming very good at that, then you start your own company, because now you have enough money through freelancing, right? You can now brand yourself. Now every app is, what's your name?
Rohit.
Okay, so you call Rohit App Design. Okay, and now because you're so good and you're in the freelancing department and you've made some great apps for people in the US or in India, your brand name has become so good. Now everyone should come to you to build an app. That's how it should be. Then you don't start coding. Then you start managing people. Then you hire coders, because now you're an expert, like mad expert. You hire people and then you tell them the exact workflow. Okay, boss, ye hona chahiye, ye hona chahiye, ye hona chahiye. You start going up to the next step. After that, maybe something else will come.
But
whatever.
When do you know, okay, you're ready to go take that step? For example, within the next 6 months, I'm learning, but I don't know if I can take many much more projects.
Yeah.
Somehow I come to know within the 8 to 9 frame that, yeah, I can take some projects, I start marketing myself, I make my own portfolio, and then I'm just taking jobs, I get these projects, I'm completing them, the new project. And then when do you just, how do you connect the dot? Like,
so when you have too many projects that you can't handle but you have to take because it's great projects, that's when you start expanding yourself and start hiring more people under you. You might get 3 more developers, tell them to sit right next to you, and they will build the app, but it's all your brains and stuff like that. That's when you know. Like when we started off, when we started in October 2017, we were doing services. It was only 5 of us, right? 5 people were doing services. We started off because even I didn't know anything about services at that point. Okay, Varun was the expert in freelancing and services. So we just got some gigs from US. So I used to write finance blog articles and stuff like that in the early days, right? Nothing I knew about marketing. Abhinav knew marketing. So we all had one client each, paying us some money, very comfortable zone. Immediately in the next 1 month, as you mentioned, since we were good, we got one project more by everyone. At one point, 5 of us were handling 15 clients. And he said, boss, we have chance in it. This is not happening because I can't sleep. I can't do anything because US clients, so I'm working all night. Right? So I had three clients that I was handling with calls everywhere. And I'm like, boss, this is too much. We need help. Okay, so then we went and hired interns because at that time we didn't have money to hire full-time people. You can't go hire 40, 50 grand people. We said, let's hire interns. So we hired 20 interns to handle our 15 clients at that point. Okay, now 20 interns are trained by us. So the client is coming. Okay, and he's like, Shashank, I need these new creatives uploaded by tonight. Earlier job, which I used to sit and upload, I used to be like, I will make it, you upload. Okay, then this guy learned a little design. I hired a design intern. I'm like, this is how I want the design, you build it. Okay, he'll build one, might be bad. It's fine, he's an intern, he has to learn. I'm like, no, don't do this. Something similar to this lines. So I offloaded that work to him, I offloaded this work to him. Now I have free time to take another client. So, but it's whose brains? Still your brains.
That's what delegation.
Yeah, you will come to a point where you realize that boss nahi ho raha hai, but mereko lena bhi hai. Unless you're in a very comfortable zone, ki, sorry boss, I have two clients, I can't take you, see you later. That's also possible. People are very comfortable when they do freelancing that I'm getting so and so money. I have no stress, I have three clients, they're all happy, I'm sorted, let me stick to this. You want to expand, that's how a company is born, right? When you start, you want to expand. Then one day your thing will be best app designs or whatever in the market. But that's how you build.
When you need one, how would you go about picking up an app developer? Not fast work. So you'll still look up their portfolio, or will it be? I need to know whether this person knows what he's doing or not. Right, I'm not saying will there be any influence, like, will it be within your network? Yeah, so we usually just put in the app on Admin now and say, do you guys know anyone? Earlier we used to ask people.
We had Tane, who teaches tech. We used to ask him, hey, do you know anyone that... So I'll tell you, when we started building this app, no, Keshav and Satya, they were not app developers. But me and Varun said, boss, we're building an app, learn it. Figure it out. Google. They took 3 months, we paid for some course online, they did some React course. But since they had coding knowledge before, it was slightly easier for them to pick it up. But they have never built an app in their life. But we said, we trust you guys more than anyone. Because you guys work day in, day out to make something successful and they have that thing inside to become successful, right? So we said, you guys learn this. It is a new skill for you to pick up. Great, we'll help you with it, whatever is required. We gave them all training material. They took 3 months to learn it. Now they're building it.
So they never knew programming at all?
No, programming they knew. App development, not much. They've heard, they've seen. Actually, they're learning. So it's a great thing. Either you self-learn, get someone from your team to pick it up and learn, if you have that willpower to do it, or get a person from outside, but after looking at his past history. Because if you're saying it's an app developer, you should be able to open that guy's app and see how it works.
Shashank, Abhinav said about this one very thing, wherein he was like, it was like a certain post on Instagram. It was like, you sell a guy a fishing rope.
You teach a guy how to fish,
and you can sell him fishing rope.
I didn't understand. Can you tell me?
You teach a guy how to fish, you can sell him fishing rope.
Yeah.
So,
you should know the answer.
Content marketing. Yeah, he wants to upgrade.
No, if I teach you how to fish and you never knew how to fish, then you need the tools to fish.
Yeah.
So, I'm going to sell you a rope, a fishing rope.
Also, you are an expert.
The other way around. If I teach him how to build a website, but I tell him, boss, Webflow, so he needs the tools to become good at something, right? If I tell you how to drive a car and you have to still buy the car, you can go to some driving school and learn how to drive. I've given you the idea of how to do a skill. Fishing is a skill. Driving is a skill. But where do you apply that? You need some tool to do that.
So, in terms of branding and in, what we can do rather than like waiting for a year and developing that complete skill, what we can do is let's say I know how to develop a form in HTML or CSS. I can like learn it in a week and create a video to for certain someone who won't know about that. Like
correct.
For some, not
correct.
Many people it would be a new thing, right?
Correct.
So you can start the branding right off when you're learning the thing, very thing. Right?
Correct.
That
correct.
Can also be a
how
good.
Do you think Meta started? I learned it, I put a video on it saying this is what I think should go out to the people. I feel every content should go out to the people. So I said, okay, I learned something, I think this should go out to people. When I put the initial content out, the ones on YouTube, right, then I realized that I have to dumb my content down even more. I have to make it even more simplified because there are a lot of people who don't understand most of the things. There was someone who asked me what inflation was. And in my head, I thought inflation sabko pata hona chahiye. But that's not the case. So then I went and made a video on inflation after that, explaining different types, how it's formed and stuff like that. So yes, you're form building, but there's another thing that a lot of people are already doing that. So how do you cut yourself out is again your branding. If I Google how to do a Google form, you know how many YouTube videos will be there? A lot. Unless it's a, even if it's a niche skill, if it's a new kind of skill, there are people doing that as well. Because it's a skill, right? Like for example, in photography and stuff like that, how to use a DSLR with aperture 50 or something like that, there are videos on that.
No, I'm going to put
it in vernacular. That's good. I mean, in India, Hindi and vernacular, Hindi is actually almost number one now. If I put an English video, if I had the same video that I put in English, if I put in Hindi, it would have worked even better. But I mean, I would have to dub it, right? But that is also something that we also have to do. But you're right, because there are a lot of people earlier, a lot of people didn't know what YouTube was. Only few people knew how to even access internet and go to YouTube. Now everyone knows how to access internet and go to YouTube. Like I see people driving autos who know how to use YouTube. I mean, they watch Chikni Chameli and all that, but still they know how to use YouTube. Like they watch something or the other. So if there is some problem, they know how to go to YouTube and Google and search it. And now Google's integrated YouTube so well. As soon as you Google, there is YouTube there. So now people who don't know English but still are coming on YouTube and learning something, which is a great thing. So vernacular is now kicking in because of that. Earlier it was not there. Earlier it was only English. So that's a great thing in India. Now vernacular, not only Hindi, now everything is coming one by one. That's why if you see all these movies also launching in all languages. Full on. So that's how it is.
Bro, how do you ask help from someone you can't give any value back to? Means I'll give an example. Like you are a busy person. If I want to ask a doubt about finance, or I want some personal help about finance, there's nothing I can give you back to, right? Matlab, you are an expert, I am a noob. I can't give you back something, right? Then how do I differentiate myself from someone who is asking for help? Like without I have to give any value.
I'll tell you what, this is something that I face almost every day. A lot of people message me on Instagram also asking very basic questions. Okay, like sir, what is stock market? Or sir, what is stock? Sir, how to buy stock and stuff like that. All these things you can Google and learn by yourself. I'm not saying no. You should develop that app, because I can't sit and tell everyone about the stock market explanation. Now value, I'll tell you where it comes. Once you do all these things, you start learning by yourself, you start Googling it, then you come to a level where you have cleared all the basic doubts. Now you have different kind of doubts.
Questions which can't be Googled.
Right? That is an interesting question.
Okay.
Right? So that will actually intrigue me also. Saying, this is a very weird thing that he's asked, which is very nice. Let's discuss. Then I will reply. Or then I come on the group and reply to something. Like for example, something happened on the finance group recently. Right? Someone said that trading is bad. Right? And then there was a big discussion on whether it's good or bad. Now that means that person has done his research. Other people have also done their research. And then they have come to an argument of discussion where is it good or is it bad, or what is the ups and downs on it. That is interesting.
Okay.
But if you ask me, sir, how to do trading? No, you have Google. You can't sit and reply what is trading and how to do trading. But discussion is very important.
I mean, I will have to show that I have done the effort and still I haven't found the answer.
The question itself will make other people understand whether you have done the effort or not.
Okay.
Your question will be in such a way that I'll be like, oh, this guy is smart. That's why he's asked me a question that even I had to think about. So then I will have the thing to reply. Then my take on this is something like this. But if it's a question that is very generic, nobody will reply. Nobody. So that's how it is.
What if I want to fetch a job in a firm who only hires a B-school people, like top school, and I have the same skill which a B-school guy has? So how do I cut through it?
So, degree is only required to get into that room, first of all, okay? Now, in today's date, that is also not that valuable, okay? Because you still get into the room somehow or the other. Because now everyone knows that even if you have a B-school degree, even if you have a foreign degree, most of the companies now have a test where you have to score some percentage to even enter the next thing. So what's the point of all that going abroad, studying, doing in IIM, IMB and all, you leave. They're actually next level, okay? But all the other colleges, B-schools that you spend a lot of money, they all have tests anyway for you to go in. Like PwC, Deloitte, most of them have tests. Like they have these normal analytical skill tests, like GMAT types, CAT types, but they have tests. So most important thing is, once you get into the room and you know you have gone into the room and someone from B school also got in, Now the only thing is about your personality and your knowledge. No one cares about your degree once you've entered. Nobody cares about it. Because I've seen a lot of people who are from B schools who have got 98%. They can't talk English or they don't have that personality of being, like, I can't picture them in the company. You will not get the job.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in, like, for example, I don't know whether you saw one video on Instagram of mine in Avalon when we went to hire the interns in Manipal.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
When we went to hire interns in Manipal, me and Varun and Abhinav had gone. We got everyone in the room. Some of them were, and we did a test again to weed out the people, right? So only the people who passed the test came. Now in that thing, as soon as everyone came with CV, and there's one very big problem, especially in India, where everyone feels that when you go into a job hunting thing, or when you go into a room, that person has more power than you, and you've already lost. A lot of people enter only losing the battle. Like, sir, please, sir, my CV, and then arrange it, open the folder, arrange it very neatly, turn it, put it in your eyes, right in front of your face. Okay, sir, this is my CV, sir, like this and that. It's not required. Ulta, the guy who's sitting and taking your interview will like it if you have that confidence when you walk in. Right? Not confident, matlab, not like Rajni can't come, put your leg. Not that way. Like, come, sir, stand straight, shake hand, how was your day? How was your day? He doesn't care about now your CV because you're talking good English, you're saying, how was your day? You're sitting down. How's it going? So must be a hectic day for you. Try something to break the ice before it actually starts. Your main job is not to show off your degree. It's actually, you're in the end, how do you get that job? Whom are you playing? Are you playing the company to get the job? No. You're playing the man sitting right in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
The guy who's going to give you the job is that guy. You have to become his friend by the end of the interview. He has to like you. Now, the degree and all that is supplementary. It's all secondary. You have to just try to play that man. Now, when you do that, most of the time you know who your interviewer is, right? A lot of people don't even do research about this person, right? No one does research about this. So you should do a research. If you're going to meet someone, do full research about his life. Go to Twitter, Facebook, go to 2011 and find what he was liking in 2011 Facebook, right?
Mm-hmm.
But don't come sit there and be like, sir, I saw your very nice, sir. You went to that Dubai trip, amazing, sir. Don't do all that. Try to put things in conversations which automatically he'll be like, correct, you're gonna have the same point of view. You do not have that same point of view. You don't care whether it's the same point of view.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want that job, he has to like you. That's also sales. A lot of sales people do that. They try to align themselves with you, right? So when you enter the thing, if there are five people sitting there, four of them, out of the two, will be full crisp iron, either the thing, sir, that way. Good. That's also good. They'll all be 95%. Most of them. Then there will be one or two people who have got 35-36% with legs up, full style. They don't even care about the job and stuff. Then there should be one person who's very mature, straight, professional. Hello, sir, how are you doing? This and that. Instead of, and now every interviewer who's sitting there also assume his point of view. He's sitting there interviewing around 100-150 people almost a day. Now everyone who comes in has the same pattern. They'll come, they'll sit in that desk, they'll all keep that interview, they'll all be silent until the interviewer talks. Interview us, okay, tell me about yourself one by one or whatever that is.
Mm-hmm.
Same routine. So if one guy comes and changes the game inside by saying something different and he initiates the conversation, automatically my boredom has increased. Now I'm like, oh, hi, what's up? This and that, something like that. And if you know he watches the cricket match and all that, put something plugged inside somewhere or the other.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Ulta, if you don't talk about work, and if you don't talk about your job and your previous history and all that, but you talk about something that two people are having a nice conversation about, you're more likely to get the job. Because as soon as you leave, you're like, I like this guy. He's a nice guy. Because they know they can train you into whatever you want to do, right? Your degree doesn't matter at that point. But they should see whether, can I work with this guy? Do I like this guy? Does he fit in the organization? That way.
But so why is it all for a B school, right?
In the end, you're playing the man. No one cares. That degree is only to get in front of that man or whatever is it, to just get in front of that person. Once you're in there, this does not matter. He will take your CV and act as if he's reading.
Yeah.
He does not care about your CV. He's seeing it, he'll be like, 80%. Good.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you let him talk about your CV, he will talk about your CV because he has nothing to do. That's what his role is. If you go in and start talking about something else, he will keep your CV down and start talking to you, man to man, face to face, whatever it is. You have to impress that way.
Yes,
and you can if he likes a particular industry, you start talking. And I'll tell you the best rule, that best one tweak or one hint that I do all the time. there's one beautiful thing in India where everyone likes to show off a little bit about their knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, everyone likes to show off something about their knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if you're telling your coder and I ask you one question, you will tell that entire thing in full style.
Mm-hmm.
Arey, mereko aata, I'll tell you how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what you should do is you should know what the other person is about, what he likes, industry. Or
mm-hmm.
even if you're going into a company which is specifically in automobile industry, fine, because you know everyone knows about automobile sector.
Mm-hmm.
You go sit in that interview. Don't initially ask this. Let the, do you go first? You do all your hi, hello, sir. How was your day? This and that.
Mm-hmm.
And that. Then you should tell him, sir. Just for 2 seconds, just forget about this because I love learning and all that. So I because it's very difficult. You're an industry expert. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So let's just forget about this for 2 seconds. Can I ask you one question?
Mm-hmm.
No one will say. Okay. Only idiots will be like, oh, time name because they'll be like, sir, one small question, 5 minutes. No one will say. Sir, then you ask a question about the industry
mm-hmm.
and try to pick his logic out. Sir, what do you think about this? Do you think it's a very good thing? Because you have to just go with one question, okay? That research you have to do about whatever company you're in. Now he will start talking, oh, I'll tell you what about this, this is this, this is that. You know, aisa karna chahiye, aisa industry hai, aisa industry and all that. You correct, sir, this is exactly what you're saying is perfectly right. And about that also is right, he's like, that also is right. You're automatically becoming friends. Now you ask him one more question. Now what happens is interviewer is not asking you questions.
Mm-hmm.
You are asking interviewer questions. Interviewer is very happy with you because he is happy that he has told you so much gyan. Thank you sir, you are very knowledgeable this and that. Hope to, you know, look forward to like being in your organization, working under you specifically.
It's all psychology.
You are playing the man,
mm-hmm.
not playing the degree, you are not playing some... If you are playing some computer, then you can't do all this, right?
Mm-hmm.
But till now you are playing the man. So make him feel happy about the interview. Don't go obviously with gifts and all, you'll be like you're bribing me, but what does he like? You have to catch that point and trigger it. That's it.
So they look for a B school in a CV, right? If you don't have a B school in a CV, they reject him. They don't even consider it.
Yeah, then why are you applying there? Nahi hai, toh nahi hai. Chalo, there's other companies also. Companies ka shortage toh nahi hai na. You know that, see, B schools, say Deloitte or whatever, they might want B schools. Or if they don't do B schools, they put you in a very small role. Right? If you are confident about yourself, your degree of whatever school you have done is only for your first job. Okay? After your first job, no one tells you, tune kaun sa school mein padha, kaun sa college mein padha, nobody cares about it. They'll be like, what was your experience in the previous company? How many years experience? And did you get a promotion or not? What was your CTC? If you're so good at something, then you apply for the same B school wala company, and if you're good there and you've got a promotion, higher chances you'll still get into them. Get it? That's it.
Cracking the first job is very hard.
Cracking the first job is getting into that room. It's a big process. It took me 3-4 months to get a job. I applied. PwC, Deloitte. They told me write a test. I'm like, no chance. Bahut padh liya, abhi nahi karna hai. Test waste ko. And also I felt a little offended, right? After learning so much, you want me to still give a test? I'm like, it's okay. I don't need to be here. I won't be happy. Let me go find something where they'll appreciate me for my skills. So I went for... My first interview was very funny. There's a company in Bandra called GLG, right? So it was, I wanted to go into management consulting or investment banking. They told me your interview is tomorrow, come. Okay, and I didn't know. Sabhi mere paas formals nahi tha kyunki main sab chhod ke aaya tha. So I went in jeans, okay, one blazer, t-shirt, jeans, and one basketball shoes. I go there and I'm sitting and I see next to me all in three-piece suit. Management consulting, all tip-top. I'm least bothered. I was like that Rajnikanth guy. I'm like, milne to nahi wala hai. Abhi to chance hi nahi. And I saw 2-3 people laughing and walking also. I'm like, cool, no problem. Then I went, I started talking to that guy. We didn't discuss about the interview. That time Jio had launched, me and him were talking about how Jio is killing the market. He's like, how do you know all this? I'm like, I read a lot. I like reading a lot. He's like, that's very good, this and that. Shuffle. But then I didn't take the job after that. Then I left. Then I'm like, nahi hoega ye mereko. Bahut sara, there was some problem on that point. I said, no need. But when I landed the investment banking job, I actually got selected only for my CV, which I shared on the group, because my CV was very different, right? That's again one more psychology that we also observe, right? When everyone gives you the same black and white CV, continuous black and white CV, same nonsense everywhere, suddenly one very different color,
paper texture,
different color, UI UX,
good
design. I will pause for 2-3 seconds and I'll be like, अच्छा बना है फर्स्ट थिंग आई विल से अच्छा बना है ये पेपर ग्लॉसी नाइस इट फील्स ऑन माय हैंड ये कौन है ये नाम तो पड़ेगा then you will be like, achha, yeah. And then if something's interesting, at least you caught someone's eye instead of going into the pile instantly, right? And all you spent was maybe 1 hour extra of your time and 5 rupees extra on good paper. You're already winning against all the stack black and white Xerox copy bundles that are there. And when you go to an interview, also take the same thing and give it to how many other people that are there. Let everyone touch and feel like, achha, bada. So automatically they feel good. And there are a lot of examples online to get innovative CVs.
One guy posted on Avalon the training trials, Prabhav Narang's Prabhav Narang's CV, he got selected, I guess, to come and work with you guys in Prestige Bear.
Oh, maybe, I don't know, that's a different
His CV now. Was something, he was just 17-year-old kid, and uska CV was very nice, and uska timeline pe, he was posting uska future ka timeline. So
yeah,
that
the amount of CVs we got was insane. Like, one guy made a website only. Website CV. Very attractive when you see
someone made a chatbot.
Someone made an entire flow.
Next time blockchain banata.
There's one guy in US who's made his CV website. Go to his website, it's a game. You drive a car, okay, and you go straight, take a right, his entire history is there of work experience. You reverse that car, go left, his education is there. Mehnat bane. But now you see, you can get a job anywhere. One time mehnat.
I've seen one with a Mario game. So, pipe ke andar, tunnel ke andar ja ke uska.
It's difficult. It's one-time effort.
Game design.
But you at least guarantee your probability of success 10 times with that. Like making a... Like a lot of people just don't put in the effort of making a good CV. But again, if you Google innovative CV templates, 100 templates are ready-made there. You can actually download the template, just put your data and sell it off. Right? I would suggest download the template and change the color also.
Canva.
Itna bhi copy nahi karna hai. I do it on PPT. Very simple for me. I take the same image, I copy paste it on PPT, then I start building the same thing next to each other. It's very simple. It's faster for me that way. Or you do Photoshop if you know Photoshop, but I prefer doing it on PPT because school time se bana PPT. So it's easy that way.
Generic question again.
How do you learn something real fast? I mean, there are already बहुत सारे videos हैं इसके ऊपर, but
हाँ repetition
हाँ बहुत videos आएगा, but अगर एक skill है जो बस अगर मुझे short time में जैसे मैंने कहा कि app development में सीख रहा हूँ मैंने 6 months का goal दिया मुझे how do you learn something really fast कि बाद में मैं उसको apply भी कर पाऊँ मुझे कितना जरूरत है कितना नहीं जरूरत
my take is you first have to go through all the videos you have to learn about it understand the base fundamentals on it read a lot about it, that's the only way you learn. Then the second way you learn is to actually get your hands dirty and start building whatever it is. Right? Because you can learn all you want, but when you actually go do it, different game only completely. You can try all that learning and all that. Once you do it, you screwed up again big time. Then you learn much more because you get stuck at so many places. It's like playing a game again. You get stuck at places, you go online to check how to go through this. Or how do people, like GTA, if anyone's played GTA, there's one helicopter mission that people got stuck forever. Yeah. So how many of you all went online and tried to figure out how to solve this? So only when you do it, you know how to go online and try to solve it with a solution. And then you feel satisfied and you'll always remember it also because you got stuck for 2 months over there or 1 month over there. So you'll always remember it. So what I do, a simple hack is what I do is whenever I watch YouTube videos and I have to learn something, I watch it at 1.2x speed or 1.5 speed. It's easy. Now I've got used to it. Obviously, initially you'll be like, "Bahut fast bol rahe." But once your brain is programmed to that, I cannot watch 1x videos now. It's difficult. Right? So I have to watch 1.25 minimum or 1.5. So then it speeds up my time of learning this. That's it. But you have to watch and learn. I also do the same. And you read a lot of articles, you read everything. It's all about putting as much data in your head as possible until it can take it. Phir log sanyas le lete.
Also, Shashan, like adding to this point, like when you were getting into like blockchain, like which is like, or something I read about, like Avalon got into for some legal. Work with a lawyer and so it's totally a new field for you, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you and you guys need to you guys are basically like a polymath, so you know like the stuff from here and here and here and there. So what's necessary in that, like going to depth or just knowing enough just to scrape through?
As long as you know what it is, you don't have to become a master in it. Jack of all trades, you should know what it is. You should be able to talk about it for at least 5 minutes.
Okay.
I'm not saying you become an industry expert and get a PhD on it. Know what it is, understand it. Now if you want to build an app, you have to become an expert. right? Mm. But if you just want to learn about an industry, mm. you don't have to become master until you want to become a master. So when, for example, when we got funded and all that, there's this document called SHA-SSA. Okay, it's called shareholding agreement and share subscription agreement.
Okay.
That has so many legal terms. Huh? Mm. I will not sign something without understanding that.
Yeah.
I literally sat, googled, what is this, what is that, what is, you know, ROFR, okay, right of first refusal. What is that? Now, the problem with legal terms is even the Google definition is legal.
Legal, yeah.
Or confusing, okay. Then you watch a video on what is that, or ROFR simplified. Google video on something will come. Why? Like, kya hai ye? Kyunki udhar bhi legal definition of a legal term. So, but now I know what it is. Now I'm not an expert. I can't tell you how this will work with that attachment and this attachment. But if you say what is RFR, I know what RFR is. Depends on how deep you want to go into.
So in layman language, we can say the T principle. You know,
yeah.
I know a little bit about these things and be a master and one thing.
That is better. Yeah. Once you master something, then you go to master something else, one by one. But the problem with mastering something is you don't know how
long it takes.
No, and you don't know whether you've still become a master or not.
Yeah.
Because the depth is, because the world is moving so fast,
mm-hmm.
that if you become a master in, say, building websites, now Webflow came. By the time you become a master in Webflow, something else will come.
You can be replaceable.
Not replaceable.
Something
keep adapting and keep learning, so you'll be stuck in that master path forever is what I'm saying. There'll never be a point where you'll be like, "Merko sab kuch aata hai."
Mm-hmm.
Always one point, you ask one question, you'll be like, "Shit, what's the problem?" Okay, then you go back to that point. So that's how it is.
Also, you guys like work so much, like possibly 16 to 18 hours a day.
Yeah.
So you guys don't
except
go
Saturday,
through.
Sunday.
So you guys don't go through a leg of burnout. You don't feel
100%. That's why I come to Bombay. No, 100%. Burnout happens big time. Like just before we launched the app. Right, I think 7-8 days was a sprint, or felt more actually, which went through. It started on January 3rd, and I think we launched on 10th or something. We were supposed to launch on 6th, which was Keshav's birthday. So we didn't know when Keshav's birthday has come and gone because we didn't celebrate it. We ordered pizza for his birthday, but we had no idea when his birthday went. When we launched the app, it felt like it was yesterday, because these guys were working 21 hours to 24 hours, then sleeping for 7-8 hours, then coming back and working for another 24 hours. So it was insane, right? But after that we gave everyone 2 days break and we said on the group, no one's disturbing. 2 days go home, chill. We all chilled for 2 days. So we believe in sprinting and then taking a break. We don't believe in that normal everyday 7-8 hours is good. But I would rather do one big sprint of 7 days, chill for another 3-4 days, another 7-day sprint, chill for 3-4 days. So your body is also fine.
But that one big sprint doesn't hamper your productivity.
No, I'm really used to it.
I mean,
it depends on passion. Yeah, I mean, see, it affects after a point. Like, after 20 hours, your brain is automatically going to shut down. So I tell them, you sleep, get up and walk again. No problem. Coffee's there. You want to sleep. You want to take a nap. So these guys go down, walk around for a while, come back. But for them, because it's problem solving, they don't get sleep.
Mm-hmm.
They only keep thinking, arey yaar, kaisa solve karna hai, kaisa solve karna. So it again comes from passion. If it was a proper 9-to-5 employee, he would have gone home at 5 p.m., 6 p.m.
yes.
saying, "Good night, guys. See you tomorrow." He would have come tomorrow. These guys would have still been awake working.
Yeah.
So they don't even get placed in.
Yeah.
That's how it is.
Shashank, talking about burnout.
Yeah.
Yesterday I listened to your TEDx video.
Okay.
And you talk about how you embrace stress, right?
Yeah.
So how do you really embrace it?
See, after a point, no. See, I tell you what. Like when you're young, we stress about a lot of things in life, okay? But have you seen also that when people are mature, or when they're 45, 50, they don't stress about the small things in life. They stress about bigger things. Because every time you grow, you're adding responsibility. And the responsibility is so big on your shoulders that the previous responsibility looks very small, right? So you have to go through that period. So for example, today, imagine your nail broke and you stressed about it, okay? After, say, 2 more times that you stressed about the same thing. So the 4th time your nail broke, you'll be like, "Hey, it keeps happening." You don't stress about it. But you will only go through that until and unless you've gone through that stressful point. So you know what is stressful and what is not. Or you should be something else, right? For something else, as in, like, say, for example, even I do this sometimes, okay? It's not very good, but I do this sometimes. So if I'm very clear about where I have to be or what I have to do in my goals, right? And I know for a fact, okay, in 3 years I have to do this. Okay, now if anything affects me today that is not going to affect the 3-year timeline, I don't even stress about it. I look at it as a short-term problem, right? So for example, today I went for the passport thing, I went late. I don't stress about it. Okay, fine. What's the worst case? Fine. I lost my bag as soon as I came. Everyone thought I would be stressing next level because it had my passport. It had all my clothes, passport, my laptop, everything. I sat and I'm like, passport can be replaced. Laptop gaya to gaya. One more I have to get. Clothes so I can buy again. What is the, like, is there something that will disrupt my entire life for the next 3 years? No. No stress. It is a process. It is annoying, but not stressful. But I've seen a lot of people stressing so much. Kya fayda? After 3 days, you're not going to stress about it. No, it's not very good also because after a point you tend to become a little unemotional also. Right? If something major happens here, I won't stress about it. You get it? So in a way it's good, in a way it's bad. That's the point. Like some people expect you to stress about something in certain situations. If a coconut falls on your head, no, I'll be logical about it. I'll be like, okay, we have to call an ambulance, we have to keep his head reset. Other people will be stressing. They'll be like, why are you so calm? Why aren't you stressing? That's also a little weird, no? So, but nahi hota. Like, but if something affects my 3-year timeline, like if the app is not happening only, then I will definitely stress. That's the thing. If it directly affects my... So there's two ways. One, go through the stress and become an expert on handling stress and don't stress about it next time. Or think, what I do is sometimes I think, what is the worst case scenario? Is it affecting me so much? Nail toota, will it grow back? Yeah, what's the worst case scenario? Thoda din ke liye ganda lagega. Or you can stress about it, waste 6 hours of your life and... then feel okay about it. That's it. But it's difficult, it's very tricky. It's not, everyone can't do it in the same. Everyone should have their own way of coping. Some people like water, some people go sit near the beach and calm down. Some people talk to their friends and calm down. Some people talk to their family and calm down. So everyone should have their own way of calm. Some people game and calm down. Like we game sometimes too. The most stress, we game and calm down. Because at that point you're not thinking about anything else apart from the game for 1 hour. So your body is automatically calming itself.
Can I ask you something, like, actually ask from you, can we have Varun Maya also next time?
Come to Bangalore, you'll get
him. No, I want him here.
That you should ask him, why you're asking me, I can't carry him and get him.
You can.
You ask him in the group, you guys say please, 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 he'll come. He doesn't like travelling, but you should, if you ask him, maybe he'll make an exception and come. See, if he comes here and talks to you for 1 hour, it is waste of his time, your time, everyone's time. You should have come for the mana event that happened, the bar event. That was best because you could get 6-7 hours of Varun at the same time. But they're planning to do one more event. If that happens, come to Bangalore. Simple. It's easier also that way. So they're planning to do one event for Metam. It's not confirmed, nothing is there in the pipeline, but they want to do something there. So that time you guys can come. Meet him also, meet everyone. Now we're investing in ourselves. Investing in startups over, we're growing this initial startup that we're doing. But as of now, whatever money we get, we're putting it back into Meta because we want Meta to grow. We don't want to get defocused again. So we're fully focused on Meta this time. So that's the idea.
Being a normal guy, how should I connect to VCs?
Yo, this is a very difficult question. LinkedIn doesn't work. Cold emailing also died. That also doesn't work. Usually it's through connections.
Mixes,
or yeah, the meetups. A lot of meetups. There are a lot of people who want to come to
Pitching competitions in
college. Competitions, meetups. Meetups as in these kind of meetups. VC meetups.
Yeah.
Then there is speed dating.
Yeah.
You don't get funded unless you're exceptional there. But you start meeting people, make connections. Okay, you use the connections later. But usually, VCs is basically a who knows who game. It's a referral game.
Just like in the job thing you told, right? Matlab, pakdo mujhe koi VC ko milna hai. Other four guys to want to meet him, right? They will talk to me about startups, things like that. Okay, aisa nahi ki mujhe startup ke baare mein baat nahi karna, but you told na ki research something about him. Pakdo, he loves cricket. Just slip something cricket in a conversation. But turns out, pakdo, not demeaning anyone, but pakdo, mujhe koi HR se baat karna hai. Okay, let's be honest, VC ka time HR se zyada like valuable, not valuable, but per capita usko zyada paisa lagta hai. Okay. Like, how do you establish the line ki bro to uska time waste kar raha hai ya phir aisa something like that?
See, first you see what everyone's doing.
Okay,
don't do that.
Okay,
now, what I would say, it's empathy. Put yourself in his shoes. Imagine you're a VC. What are you doing daily? There are 100 startups coming to you. What are you talking about? Sir, I'll tell you, my startup is best. Okay, what we are doing is we have this innovative technology, okay, which is futuristic and amazing. and nonsense, five keywords he'll put inside that.
Mm-hmm.
And be like, sir, this is awesome, you should buy into this.
Mm-hmm.
Same, direct. Yeah, mera bottle, amazing thing, I'm selling in US, I'm selling here. Everyone shows off about their product left, right, center. And they'll be like, sir, you should invest in this. He's listening to this 100 times.
100 times, huh?
What is different is, like what me and Varun do is, number one, and the biggest problem with when people go to VCs is the same problem that I told you with jobs and things.
Mm-hmm.
Startups always feel that you have already lost the battle and they are the winners.
Establish the hierarchy, like warm set back.
They always feel that that person has more power than you.
Okay.
VCs have more power than you.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you are smart enough to know the industry, you know for a fact that today there are thousands of VCs. And there are VCs from US also investing in India.
Yeah.
So if one guy says no, there are 999 people left.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing against VCs, but I'm saying there are a lot of people, so don't feel bad. So I've seen a lot of people, as soon as they go in, they feel this is their only, you know, chance at life.
Mm-hmm.
No, but if you go with again confidence, now you're keeping the power table safe.
Mm-hmm.
If you go like a person who's desperate for it, he already has more power than you, he will squeeze you like hell.
Wow.
So what me and Varun do is, one, we keep the power table always balanced, okay? Because we know for a fact if you get or we don't get, we are not bothered about it, because we believe in ourselves that we will build it anyhow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that is number one. That much confidence you should have. Second thing is, when you go and meet a VC, talk about a story.
Mm-hmm.
Do not talk about your product. Do not even talk about it for all of that. Talk about the story. Everyone loves stories. Everyone loves stories. When they're basically investing, one, in your product and two, in yourself, right? They're investing in the founders. You tell them a story, right? First you ask them about their introduction. They will tell you through the things. You should be like, wow, amazing, this and that. Now you know exactly what he likes, what he doesn't like. Then you start telling, instead of telling, sir, I'll tell you what my product is, I'll tell you how it began. I'll tell you how the story started.
Mm-hmm.
So me and Varun started this in 2017. It was a very good ride, this and that. Then we had a few ups and downs, this and that. By the time you reach your product, that guy's already so engrossed in your story, it's storytelling. He's already like, wow, this is something great. Then we came to this idea of doing something like, say, Meta.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what we aim to achieve. Meta was only 5 minutes. The entire pitch was 30 minutes. 25 minutes was the story, 5 minutes was Meta. Then he'll only be like, so what is your plan in this? Oh yeah, fishing rod, fishing, whatever you call it, is good. But if you're directly such a Meta is an education app which we're also doing for gaming and this and that, he'll be like, one more is coming.
Haan, but this is the assumption ki bhai tumhare paas 30 minute hai. Okay, like
aisa kuch nahi hota ki 30 minute mein dekho hakal dega. First of all, you have 30 minutes, tell a story for 30 minutes. There's two things that will happen.
Mm-hmm.
Either he'll love your story and be like, let's extend this little more and talk. Okay, so he'll only start talking to you, he can push other meetings. Possible, right? If he cannot push other meetings and he only has 30 minutes, he'll be like, I like this, meet me tomorrow at another time. So it's not like in 30 minutes you have to go pitch your product and come out.
Mm-hmm.
30 minutes, 20 minutes you tell your story, 10 minutes you pitch your product. Okay, that and don't pitch it in a way that he has to invest.
Buy
in.
It. Invest.
Pitch it in a way, again, that story has to come out. Why you did this? What are you trying to solve? What will happen if you solve this? So if you do this, sir, a lot, just imagine a lot of people who have no idea about this will learn about finance and marketing and stuff like that. And we're keeping it at very, like, free, so that it's affordable for everyone.
Mm.
We also wanted to go to Vernacular, so we said, look, just imagine if an auto rickshaw driver's son wants to learn this, he can also come on the app and learn in his own language.
Mm.
I'm not selling, I'm selling the app, but I'm also putting the story out, which is the real story. So they will connect to the story more, because now in their head, it's a humans picturize everything, right? So you have to create that picture and come on there. Or else it'll never work.
Yeah, I recently joined the Avalon Army. You know, I just want to know more about what is Meta and Beta.
So this is one of those questions I don't answer.
I'll let you know.
After Beta's come out, you're asking me what is Meta. That you should ask other people. If I sit and explain, no, we'll go 1 hour.
I'll just tell you my scenario. So currently, you know, we have this committee in my college, and I'm heading that committee. So, you know, as a head of that committee, I have a vision that I'm to achieve so and so and so. But I also my other core members in that committee. So how do I align them to the vision I have?
Okay, so first, your vision has to be good and not stupid.
Yeah, okay.
Okay? Second, if your vision is good, you will automatically have people aligning to you if you give that vision out in a good way. Right? You have to portray that vision out in a good way. Like, you say, if you want to help the poor or something like that, you have to put it in such a way that people want to help you. They should feel like helping you. Because again, it's your vision, not their vision. So to make it their vision, you have to align it in such a way. Again, create a story for aligning the vision.
can I add something?
Yeah, you can.
So actually, last year we had this technical project thing.
Can I explain
something? So our project was very simple, like dot matrix display using Arduino. And there were plenty of other guys who had this very expensive projects like that 3Ds wale helicopter and other expensive stuff. So the and actually we won that competition, and the reason why we won is that we explained the jury in such a way, we presented it in such a way that, you know, the this product will apply here, or it is cheaper for people to you know, buy it. So that's why we like won. So the main thing is like how you present it, even though it is not that good. Your presentation skills are...
A judge is different, presenting it to a team member is a different thing.
Yeah, but
that's what I feel.
Offer them pizza.
No, it really does work, right, for us.
हाँ बट यू डोंट ऑलवेज मीट पीपल हु आर अलाइन टू योर विजन राइट मतलब पकड़ो तुम्हारे साथ कोई तो बंदा है हुम यू आर वर्किंग विथ राइट ही माइट नॉट बी एज पैशनेट अबाउट समथिंग मतलब पकड़ो तुम्हारा कोई गोल है ओके तुम्हें कोई ऐप बनाने का कॉन्सेप्ट है ओके ही माइट नॉट बी एज पैशनेट लाइक यू फॉर दैट गोल मतलब इसमें थोड़ा डिफरेंसेस क्रिएट होता है राइट मतलब मैं ज़्यादा एफर्ट डालेगा हिज एफर्ट माइट नॉट बी दैट मतलब पकड़ो मैं कोडिंग में कर रहा हूँ वो मार्केटिंग में कर रहा हूँ ओके मेरा कोडिंग में एफर्ट बहुत सही जा रहा है ओके बट उसका मार्केटिंग में ज़्यादा नहीं आ रहा ऐसा
अगर तेरा लीड है तू एफर्ट डाल रहा है बट देन अगर तुझे कहीं नहीं वो अपना कॉलेज के ग्रुप प्रोजेक्ट जैसा ही हो गया कि टीचर ने पांच लोग को काम दिया लेकिन एक बंदा है जो स्लैक ऑफ
वो एक ही कर रहा है
तो एक टाइम पे या तो तेरे को रिप्लेस करना पड़ेगा जाके बताना पड़ेगा इज नॉट पुटिंग इन मच एफर्ट वरना वो सिर्फ एक
So this one thing that Steve Jobs once did to bring John Sculley was a CEO of...
Guys, I'll have to leave in 5 minutes.
Yeah. So John Sculley was CEO of Coca-Cola and he wanted to bring him in Apple. So he said this one sentence to John Sculley. Like, do you want to sell sugar water or come with me and change the world? So like how you pitch in is the main thing.
हाउ डू रियलाइज यू आर नॉट पैशनेट अबाउट समथिंग एट दिस पॉइंट मतलब पकड़ो मैं अभी ना एक साल से कोडिंग कर रहा हूँ ओके बट अभी मेरा ऐसा है कि आई कांट कोड फॉर लाइक मोर देन वन और टू आवर मतलब तभी ऐसा बर्न आउट हो जाता है
इफ इट डजंट लेट यू स्लीप एट नाइट देन यू आर पैशनेट अबाउट व्हेन यू आर स्लीपिंग इफ इट इरिटेट्स यू देन यू आर पैशनेट अबाउट एंड इफ यू फील गिल्टी अबाउट नॉट डूइंग समथिंग यू आर पैशनेट अबाउट
गो टू स्लीप
आई डोंट शूट अ फ्यू वीडियोस आई फील गिल्टी अबाउट सो आई गेट अप एंड लाइक नहीं नहीं Just shoot this and sleep. So I'm, it's like that. Andar se wo irritation hota. That's when you know you like something.
Right.
It's, if you let it go, then you're not, you don't like it so much. Kar rahe, because you're doing it, because you have to do it, you're doing it. That's the only thing.
एक author है नसीम तालब करके उसका कैसा मतलब he told if your team wants to find the highest mountain in your area okay then what you do is you divide your team into two parts एक team पूरा search करता है okay मतलब one team like goes to one state and all मतलब they just search the flatlands okay and एक team top पे जाता है मतलब पकड़ो एक you got the concept right but पकड़ो तुम solo okay now I'm interested in a lot of concepts right मतलब फिलहाल psychology में मेरा बहुत interest चल रहा है but also that skill doesn't necessarily bring money on the table okay ऐसा मतलब आई लाइक सर्चिंग थिंग्स अलॉट ओके ऐसा नहीं कि आई डोंट लाइक टू गो इन टू डीप इन वन थिंग बट आई लव टू गो डीप इन टू वन थिंग ओनली व्हेन आई एम रियली श्योर अबाउट इट ओके देन हाउ डू यू फाइंड दैट स्वीट स्पॉट व्हेन यू आर श्योर दैट कि ब्रो अभी मैंने बहुत देख लिया नाउ लेट मी गो एट दिस पीक लेट मी फाइंड आउट इफ दिस पीक इज द हाईएस्ट और समथिंग लाइक
दैट यू नो फ्रॉम इनसाइड दैट्स व्हाट आई एम सेइंग
एग्जैक्टली
यू हैव टू टेस्ट एवरीथिंग एंड समथिंग विल टेस्ट गुड फॉर यू इट विल बी डिफरेंट फॉर एवरीवन व्हेन यू feel that ye mere ko acha I think I should go deep that's yourself telling that I like this let me go check it high chances you might like it like you know the pehla okay you think it's love but it's not love you think you love that person but it's not baad mein realize hota hai are infatuation tha tu piche jayega fir pata chalega nahi hai fir tu wapas dhoondega similar very similar
so you talking about finding your passion and doing what you love So if you have not figured out that, so only one way is like trying out new things. So how much time you should give to that specific thing?
As much time as you can. Keep trying out until you find it. I'll tell you why. Because even if you find it late, it's good because half the people can't find it out. So take your time and find it. People figure it out. Even if you're 30, 35 and you find your passion, you have enough time in life to do something about it. Right? So take your time and find it. Don't rush it. Right? You have time. Enough time. But take your time and find it, because a lot of people don't find it and it's so sad, because people still be like, I still don't know what I'm passionate about.
Mm-hmm.
It's because you've not tried everything. Maybe there's something that everyone has something that will spark them, but they've not reached that point. Maybe they'll reach it now if they're adventurous, they'll go expose themselves to reach it faster. Or if you're sitting at home and watching Netflix, you will not reach that goal.
Yeah.
Maybe one day after 3-4 years you will go to some place and suddenly you'll get, you know, you'll meet it. So it's like that. The more you put yourself
like,
out there.
I have like, we have marketing come programming and let's say finance. So I want to figure out what works for me better. So like how much time I should spend in each thing to compare.
Dude, I'm telling you, if you actually have passion about something, within a day you will figure out that you like something or not. If you watch 5 videos and you'll be like, hey, what a ch- I like this a lot. Then you go into it more. Then you figure out whether you just like it for that moment or you actually like it.
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't, if it comes in your dreams or you don't sleep in the night, then you've got your thing.
What if I'm passionate about something and that's not scalable or it doesn't bring me much money?
No, no, you can, if you're passionate about something,
yeah,
you can always figure out something or the other to make it scalable, make money, whatever. Because if you're passionate about something, you're thinking of something which is already people are doing and they're not making money or already people are there. But if you're passionate, you will always find another way inside.
Also, adding to what Sashank said, I read in some book like if you like if you're passionate about something and you're not you're failing in it like in the start, you're not good at it. But the fail there is fun in failing in that. That's basically one thing that also.
Yeah, you'll keep learning to become an expert in that because you love it.
Yeah, you'll not feel bad about it that much if
you. When you fail, you'll be super happy and excited, and that will actually irritate you when you don't. Get an answer, you get irritated.
Mm-hmm.
So that will push you to go find the answer more. It's like searching for your answer. Either you find it online or you go talk to someone and be like, "Mere ko iska samajh mein nahi aa raha. Explain this. I want to know this. I want to solve this in my head." You'll reach that a point. It is very irritating, but it's a fun kind of irritation.
You're just willing to do it after you fail, and that's fantastic.
Yeah.
The UP admins have a lot of people saying that having a tech founder among
the founders
is very important.
It is. It is now. Sadly, in today's date, it is. Because most of the things revolve around tech.
Yeah.
Right? It's always good to have someone who knows tech. Doesn't necessarily have to build tech. You should know tech. Because you can hire people to build tech.
Yeah.
But if it's two non-tech co-founders, me and Varun both were finance guys and we hired a developer to do this, he could turn me left, right, center, I would never know what he's doing. Right?
Yeah.
So it's good to have someone who has
some,
a technical
idea,
know-how.
But not,
doesn't have to
not,
build.
Yeah.
Doesn't have to build. But it's not that someone comes to him and marks him.
But it can again be outsourced, you know, the work and everything. But
yeah, so Varun doesn't have to sit and build the app.
Right.
Right, but if someone comes and gives bullshit to Varun, Varun can catch the bullshit.
And how do we hire a guy who's also, I mean, a very strong question maybe.
Yeah.
So maybe on those freelancing websites or something, looking at their past.
Yeah. Or find someone who's passionate about your idea, give him equity and tell him go up. Right. Not always about physical money, it's also about equity. They can still work in their own job and help you on the side.
If I ask them to do it in part time or something,
part-time.
And then give them
a timeline. Once you feel that it's, I think I need to be full time on this. Everyone will feel it at the same time. You should, this is working, now you should go full time on this. Then everyone will quit and come. Because now you're all passionate about the same thing. When everyone's passionate about something, it has to become a thing. One thing.
Said ki there are a lot of people doing the same thing around.
Yeah.
You need to have that one feature that you can pitch and you will be like, this is unique and you need
one
to buy
feature
this.
Or one business model.
Business model.
Exactly. Feature is still copied.
Mm-hmm.
It's not one feature is useless.
So you have a unique business model.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Something so proprietary that it'll take them 6 months to copy.
Okay. So what if there is already a technology that is existing outside and I just vary the use case.
You can do that.
Reading the use case and then designing
you
the
can do that.
But according to
if
that.
Someone's already doing that, how much time will it take for him to vary the use case, like how you did if it's working? Think
that's
like
the question that I need to
yeah,
ask.
Yeah, think like that. Right? But if you're saying it'll take him 6 months minimum, because I've varied it in such a way that he doesn't know what I'm doing, then yes. Right? But if you tell him, I think ek mahine mein aa jayega, itna bhi kuch complicated nahi tha. Then you're fooling yourself. Then you and 1 month is not a good thing to have a difference. You have at least 6 months. Because by the time he figures out tune kya kya 6 mahine mein tu kuch aur karega jo usko aur 6 mahine lagega, so you have to always stay one step ahead. That way.
And it's such a good idea because in developed countries there are a lot many things which is happening, like many startups are copying the thing in
see because
in
globalization is happening,
so
everything can work everywhere.
Yeah, that's what
earlier
I'm
it was like, it was not like now a lot of you guys have go to US, Singapore, blah blah blah, you see that there are ride hailing apps everywhere.
Mm.
Different ones like Grab Singapore,
yeah.
Lyft, in US and stuff like that. Ola and Uber in India. So it is possible. Food delivery also started the same. So
and
it's fine.
Pretty much has the same business model.
See, every country now has their own ride hailing app.
Yeah.
There's no innovation. It's just first mover advantage. And execution.
Execution.
So there is
execution.
One problem I personally face is I am a finance guy. I did my MBA in finance and everything, but I don't feel so much connected to it.
Hmm.
However, I am exploring myself into various other business
Good.
Models where in last 3-4 years I have found out 2 to 3 things which I feel, I personally think or research, there is no competition in India. For
That's
those
good.
Things.
Yeah.
But just like you said, you should be good at it.
Mm-hmm.
Or you should have a
yeah,
passion.
So if you know there's no competition,
yeah.
Be careful because competition aayega jaldi abhi.
Aayega jaldi.
So
yeah.
Become an expert fast. Don't waste, don't be like, ek saal ke baad tak I will do research, tab tak 5 competition. The way the world is going. So if you found something that no one's gone into, go super fast. Don't waste time. Then do that only.
When we first met, you said you consider doing a management consultancy job or investment
yeah.
because you wanted to go through different business models.
Yeah.
So that's how you got your into how business models work maybe
Correct.
And
that is
how
my passion in that.
Yes.
Yeah.
So coming from a tech side,
mm.
I don't see business models that often.
Mm.
Unless and until I see a company which is running its business model and
mm.
data hoga to padne milta. So how do you go about exploring stuff like that? Like mere ko ek specific
Google education sector, Google it. You can just Google how does Byju's work. You know how Byju's works. How does Swiggy work? You know how Swiggy works. So that's a different business model. Which business, which company's business model you're talking about that there's no information out there that how it works. How does X company make money? 100 articles. Everyone will give their own gyan also. Assumptions also are there. That aisa banata hoga bhi. तो उसका इंडस्ट्री में और कौन है उसको पूछ कैसा चलता है
network.
Or anyone from that industry, if he's so niche and he's good, people must have heard about him.
Yes.
People must have assumed again.
Hmm.
So you will again connect dots. So that's how you do it.
Also, Shashank, coming back to like
yeah, last question, na?
Making people work on regarding of money and equity. Like if like 5-4 guys are starting up, okay.
Hmm.
So then how do you like divide equity and like you know
equity
capital?
I mean, what?
The
stupid people do is they say sabko equal equal milega the worst okay because when you do equal equal that means you're giving equal equal authority to everyone which in today's base you're assuming that they're all friends and they're all good baad mein kya problem hoga it's another level so even I think housing.com also had a lot of equity founders at the start right? I think some 10 people they had started out but you divide it by seniority wise whose idea who's the CEO usko jyada milega hi Then there is finance marketing, somewhat average range. Okay, or you divide it according to cost. How much can you get into the business? Right? If we need 1 lakh to start this business, you're getting in 50 grand, you take 50%. You're getting in this much, you take this much. Either by money, because now you're skin in the game, right? You're putting 50 grand means you need to get that much.
Yeah.
Or if you don't want, if there's no capital required initially, then you only go on skills and who's good and who's bad. Who's the CEO? You have to decide. There will be a lot of people who will be like, hey, I don't do this. मैं ये मार्केटिंग समझ रहा हूँ सो यू ऑब्वियसली गेट द मोस्ट दैट
ओके लास्ट
हां ओके
वेयर आर यू फ्रॉम मुंबई
चेंबूर बट आई थिंक आई टोल्ड ऑन द ग्रुप आल्सो ओके कूल गाइस आई थिंक द रेस्ट ऑफ द डिस्कशन कैन बी डन इंटरनली
या एन इंटरेस्टिंग क्वेश्चन ऑन द ग्रुप